or response plan, as you recall, has four phases: the inter-pandemic phase, the alert phase, the epidemic phase, and of course the recovery phase. But we are still in the epidemic phase.
Living with COVID means, first and foremost, that we always have to be cautious. We cannot let our guard down. As I like to say in parochial terms, COVID still a keep, and therefore people must not ever get complacent. Despite the successes that we have had, the fact is that as we lift restrictions, there are issues that will have to be confronted in terms of surveillance, in terms of managing the possibility of a greater risk profile. The ministry has been working on a plan in recognition of living with COVID. And the risks that are associated with that. There are some specific things that we have to do and are doing contained in that plan. These include a review of the existing legislation to bring them in alignment with international health regulations, requirements, and the drafting of policies that support infection prevention and control measures at home, in the communities, and at the workplace. So it's a review of the process that clearly reinforces the general messaging that we have been pushing around: physical distancing, wearing of masks, sanitizing, cleaning surfaces, and this is going to be the new standard operating procedure, the new normal that we like to call it. The strategic and human resource review of the Health Emergency Operations Center, EOC, we're here now at the physical space, to increase the capacity to respond to multiple and varied disasters, and the documentation of EOC procedures. Creation of some 2,208 posts for community health aides, significant addition of capacity, making existing health aid workers, community health aid workers who are temporary permanent, so they have security of tenure, adding another 1,000 to 1,200 which has started, and they are going to be the sort of army out in the community, monitoring, encouraging, teaching, motivating, handing out brochures, and bringing back information, intelligent information, as to what is happening that may represent a risk in a particular area. So targeting vulnerable groups, the old, those with comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, helping them to go to their clinics, a range of things. These community health aides are going to be absolutely critical as we shift heavily into surveillance as opposed to just sort of testing. And surveillance will become the dominant feature of the approach. Another 500 posts for public health inspectors, again, an important development. And training for contact tracers. A big part of our success has been those men and women who go out in the field to take the risk, to test people, to visit homes, and we're going to reinforce that. A review of the organizational structure of the medical officers of health in each parish with a view to enhance the capacity to respond to emergencies will be also an important part of that issue system. Critically also, part of the COVID plan or recovery plan from a public health perspective is the development of a national lab policy, including a system of licensing of labs and requirements for conformity to a national quality standard. So people say a lot, why we don't use the private labs to outsource testing? Truth is, private labs, as it relates to COVID, do not have the equipment, do not have the accreditation, and do not have the training to either collect the samples or to test. And so it is not that we want to do everything in the public space at the university or at the National Public Health Club. It is because we are the only ones that are accredited to do it and the only ones with the machines to do it. Now, we need to play catch up, but better late than never. We need now to get our private labs engaged so that should an event like COVID reoccur, we can manage through collaboration with the private sector. And that has started. We started to train some members in the private space. Accreditation will take some time, but even if it's just for collecting of samples, that is going to be very possible. So That's going to be a very important part of the process. And finally, the approach will involve an assessment of the sea and airport protocols. So the idea around ensuring we have the protective gear, the training, if necessary, the expansion of staff, isolation rooms, all the gadgets that are required, because it is in the coming and the going of Jamaicans and non-Jamaicans that contagious diseases can spread. And so we need to review that process and enhance that process. So all contained will be part of a plan, which we will unveil in due course, that will represent the new norm, if you will, and over the next year or so, for however long COVID lasts as a threat, we will engage stakeholders to be a part of offering that solution. To the extent that any campaign, or frankly speaking, any activity involving multiple persons is to take place, whether it's in the church or at a bar, which is now allowed, the protocols would be very clear in the COVID period as to issues around infection prevention and control. Some of them are known, you know, so the masks would be important. The physical distancing, so we you know, it's hard because persons as Jamaicans are used to the touchy-feely type of approach. We are a friendly people for the most part, and so you have to encourage, and that would be a protocol that would be important. And of course, the sanitization. In fact, I've been visiting some institutions, you know, whether it's a church or a school or a shop or a bar, and I'm quite impressed with the fact that a number of them have put in place makeshift sanitizing stations, if you will. They just take a bucket, they punch a hole in it, put a little pipe onto the bucket, they have some hand washing, you know, detergent or soap, and they elevate it on a stand, and they put a little handwritten piece of paper onto the bucket and say, sanitize or wash your hands. And you know, you don't need to be sophisticated to achieve the objective. Many have done that, I have seen it, and that is something that we should encourage.
In going about our day-to-day business nowadays, we have to pretty much assume that everybody has COVID. And so therefore, how we operate within our business spaces, within our recreational spaces, within our homes, we have to take that into consideration. And that is what really living with COVID is about. The fact is that you cannot tell if somebody has COVID. You cannot tell if, you know, they were symptomatic when they were coughing outside the door and they stepped in and they're not coughing now. You can't really tell if they were sitting at the table in front where you are now sitting and they have coughed all over or sneezed or anything and the droplets are on the table and you've touched it. So you really have to operate in a space now where you assume that persons have COVID and you always carry out your infection prevention and control measures.